So this morning, by the special grace of God, I'm teaching on omnipresence, the ever-present God. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you praise. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Grant us utterance. And let Jesus be revealed in Jesus' name. So let me start with on this note. You see, some of the, well, I would say, mind-blowing, or what some of the greatest miracles God has done through my hands, we are not done in the church. It was not done in cameras. It was rather done behind closed doors. Let me say it again. Some of the mind-blowing, strange miracles God has done through my life, through this my hand, was never done in a church program. It was not done where people can see it. Many of them we are done in my room. Some of them we are done at our car park. Some of them we are done inside the school. But it was really done in a place that you wouldn't expect such miracles to happen. If I'm to recount some of them, I've already shared the testimony of how I went to visit my brother, and the neighbor had been sick for years, approximately like 23 years. When I woke up that morning, I wasn't really fasting. I wasn't feeling any fire. I wasn't in any mood. You can say that this guy woke up spiritual today. I was pressing my phone, just being my normal self. And that woman walked into the room. But after I was done ministering healing to her, she left. You wouldn't believe that it was the same person that walked in that left that room. I remember one time I went to visit my friend Dayo, and I noticed that the elder brother that came to see him, was the guy was so uncomfortable. It was written all over him. You know, that evening when I left that shop, Dayo called me and asked of my whereabout. I told him I'm at home. So they came to Naima to see me. I met them at our car park, and he told the brother to talk to me. The brother came to me and said, sir, that his younger brother has told him that I normally pray for the sick and all that, that he had this issue with his private part, that he is more like an infection, you know? And he's been trying to get the medication along the side, but to no avail, that if I can please pray for him. It was in that car park I conducted like a deliverance for him, because he was almost slain under the anointing. And that was it. The same person that came, in fact, if you saw the way he came, you will know that this guy was really in pain. As he was leaving, he was so happy. I think that same evening we were going for this pastor, 6 hours of praying in the Holy Ghost. When we got there, when they were conducting Holy Ghost baptism, I asked him, do you speak in tongues? He said, go ahead and receive it. He left filled with the Holy Ghost, filled happy. I think he rather touched me money out of excitement. I've shared again of a guy that met me in school one time. I was almost being strangled by one funny power. I can't even explain what was happening to him. It was right there in that noisy classroom that I conducted a deliverance for him. Now, I'm not sharing these things to show that a man is powerful. The reason why I'm recounting the stories for you is that I want to share with you the secret behind those exploits. You see, if you can know what men know, you can do what they can do. I've always said that the difference between myself and the medical practitioner is knowledge. You might be more good looking than your doctor. You might even be taller than him and all that. But the reason why he is addressed as a doctor is because of what he knows. The difference between myself and a doctor is what I know. My sound knowledge of the Bible. Are you getting what I'm saying? So what really makes men is not their color, is what they know. Knowledge is more like the secret behind every exploit. Guess what I know? I know omnipresence. It has been registered in my consciousness that Jesus is always with me. Because, like I said, when I conduct these deliverances or minister these healings. On many occasions, I don't feel anything at all, anything. But there is a knowing I have. Like I was teaching yesterday, is a knowing by experience. It's that kind of knowing when the Bible said that an Adam know his wife. That's like consummating, what you can call consummation in marriage. It's knowledge by experience. I taught us yesterday that there are four or five Greek words for knowledge. There is the one they call gnosis. There is even cerebral knowledge. There is epignosis. There is eidos. There is ginosko. I don't have time to do all those things this morning. But the one I can pick out of all of those things is epignosis. Knowing, I've taught us many times at our outreach programs, knowing by acknowledgement. It is the same knowing that Paul was, when he was writing to, in the book of Philemon 1:6, he says that the communication of your faith will be effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you. You acknowledge every good thing that is in you, that is also in Christ Jesus, knowing that you have been engrafted into Christ. But the only way you can walk in those dimensions, you daily acknowledge it, that the power of Jesus lives in me. So whether I wake up right now and you bring any case, I'm not confident in myself. Ephesians 6 from verse 10, it says that you should be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. My strength comes from knowing that the great one lives in me. You can see a 32 years old man, but I bet you that is not all that I am. There is God in me. So what you must, and that is the same thing every believer have, Jesus living in us. But you can't do this exploit until it registers in your subconscious mind that you are more than what the eyes can see. And that is why I'm starting on this note, because my topic again is omnipresence, ever-presence, ever-present God. That the God whom we serve is ever-present. No situation can lock him out. You feel him, you don't feel him, he is there with you. You know it, you don't know it, he is there with you. Are we following? Now let me introduce my scriptures so that we can talk scriptures. Matthew chapter 28, from verse 18 to 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all the things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Jesus started by making a vital statement. All power is now in my custody. Any power you think that be is in my possession. Now you can go. He's now sending us forth. He also brought it to their notice. I am, even though it seems like I'm about to go, I am with you always. But now, me being with you is in the spirit. You don't need to feel me, but you must know I am with you. Irrespective of what you experience, I am with you. Irrespective of where you find yourself, I am with you. So when they bring any case to you, I am with you. This must register in your subconscious mind. They wake you up right now. Jesus is with you. You don't need to feel him. He's a spirit. You don't need to feel a wind to believe that the wind is real. Yes, sir. I am with you. This thing I'm teaching to you are the things that form the basis of what I do. Mark chapter 16, 19 to 20. So then, after the Lord has spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord walking with them and and confirming the world with signs and wonders following. Are you seeing that? The Lord walking with them. In other words, wherever they go, God was there. Wherever they found themselves, God was there. That's the omnipresence. When you are sleeping, do you know that Jesus is right there with you? As I'm talking to you right now, do you know that he's right there with you? I don't know the country you'll be listening from or you are listening from. Do you know that God is there with you? No matter the economic crisis, no matter your health condition, no matter the doctor's report, I am with you always. He doesn't take a break. He's with you. This must sink into you if you really want to do exploits for the kingdom. And if you really want to survive in this day where there are challenges, bad reports here and there, you must internalize this, that he is with me. Are we following? Are we following? So the supernatural is not really about church environment. We were not even sent to the church. We were sent into the world. Go ye. Because these days, people think it's until you come to church you will experience miracle, or until you are in a church setting that the power of God will flow. That's not true. No, that's not true. We are actually light sent into a dark world. We are meant to go shine forth our light. Are we following? So I don't need a pulpit to demonstrate the power of God. No, I don't need to come to church to demonstrate it. Jesus never had a pulpit. The Bible says he went about doing what? Doing good. And that's the same ministry we've received from him. The world is our parish. Anywhere you are, whether you are in a bus, whether you are in an apron, wherever you are, and there is a need to demonstrate the Jesus you believe in, you must demonstrate him because of what? I am. That's Emmanuel, God with us. Are we following? Are we following? That's the same thing in Colossians chapter 1 verse 27 was telling us. It says, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of those mysteries among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you. As long as Christ is in you, then your life has no other option but to decimate or demonstrate glory. The reason why we can show forth those glory is because he is in us. When he said in Matthew chapter 5, I believe, verse 16, that let your light so shine before men, it's because he knew that once I am in you, you will show forth your light. That light shining forth is as a product of Christ in me, the hope of his glory. Omnipresence. That's still our topic. Are we together? So even our Lord Jesus, all of those exploits he did in ministry was as a product of God being with him. Acts chapter 10, 36 to 38. He says, the word which God has sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word, I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee, after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. For what? God was with him. The exploits of our Lord Jesus was because God was with him. God was with him. You too, right now, if you are a born-again Christian, you are also anointed with Holy Ghost, and you are also anointed with power. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of power. So when he says, tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued with power, that's referring to the first apostles. Right now you have the Holy Ghost, and the presence of Jesus in you is actually what is power. That is the power. So everything Christ did was also as a result of God being with him. Are we following? Are we following? Are we following? So maybe someone is asking, maybe someone will be asking, Apostle, you said God is with me always, but where was he when I lost my wife? Maybe someone who might be probably listening to the station, maybe that's your question. Where was he when I lost that contract? Where was he when I was cheated out of that contract? Where was he when they paid me back evil for the good I rendered to them? Where was he? Where was he? Where I lost everything, even though I was a faithful tither, even though I'm a committed Christian, where was this God? How do you want me to believe that he is with me and I'm going through all of this? How do you want me to believe that he is with me and this thing has befallen my family? Like I normally tell people, I don't always claim to have the whole answers, but I know if you will listen, God will speak to you through my voice. Are we following? The truth of the matter is that God is always with you. Right now in that situation, he is. God was always with you, no matter what you've passed through. God is with you right now under the sound of my voice. Situations, challenges, doesn't take him away from the equation. He's there. Are we following? The little thing is that you allowed your temporal challenge blind you of knowing that he is with you. You see, Jesus is our pattern man. And he made a statement in the book of John chapter 10. I beg your pardon. He made a statement that the Father is always with me. Even though he was criticized, even though he was misunderstood, but he said what? The Father is always with me. I'm quoting John chapter 8, 29. He said, he that sent me is with me. The Father had not left me alone, for I do always those things that praise him. Though the Father was with Jesus, he was criticized. Though the Father was with Jesus, he was misunderstood. Though the Father was with Jesus, there were times they wanted to throw him off the cliff. They made attempts on his life several times. But yet he says, the Father is always with me. So the Bible says in Psalm 34 verse 18, it says, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of broken heart, and saved such as be of a contrite spirit. The reason why he had to say only the contrite spirit will experience his saving grace is because when you are puffed up in pride, you won't even know you need grace. So you've allowed your temporal situation rob you from acknowledging or perceiving this fact that God is still with you, that his grace is sufficient for you. It was Apostle Paul that told us that three times he asked the Lord to take away that thorn on his flesh, and God told him that my grace is sufficient for you, and that God's grace is made manifest in our weakness. It's even in our weakest moments that his grace is fully expressed. Yes, sir. God is with you. He has not abandoned you. He has not abandoned you. I will follow you. If you are still following me, type praise the Lord on the comment section. I want to be sure that you are following. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, like I said, Jesus is our pattern man. Jesus is our pattern man. Because someone might be asking, I have been praying for God to deliver me from this. I have been fasting. I've done everything I was told to do for God to deliver me from this, for God to save me from this. Why is he not showing forth? Let me answer that with scripture. Matthew 26, from verse 37 to 44, I read. This is about our pattern man, Jesus, our Lord. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and watch with me. And he went a little farther, and fell on his face and prayed, saying, Oh, my father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh again unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and said unto Peter, What? Could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time, and prayed, saying, Oh, my father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. This is our Lord, Master Jesus. Jesus, before he was to face his persecution and trials, and he was praying, Lord, please take this cup away. Take this cup away. His humanity came into being that moment. His humanity wanted to take full control of him. Remember, he was a God man. Even though he was a God, he was still fully 100% human. So as a human who fully knew what he's about to experience, he was scared of going through that cross. He went to pray, Lord, if it's possible, take this cup away. The Bible says he did it 3 times, and each of those 1 time he prayed for at least 1 hour. The question is, was he heard? Let's start from there. Remember, he told us that the Father is always with him. So that same Lord whom the Father is always with was calling on that same Father who is always with him. The question is, was he heard? I will answer it again with this scripture. Hebrews chapter 5, we'll read 5 to 7. So also Christ glorifieth not himself to be made an high priest, but he that saith unto him, Thou art my son, today I have begotten thee. As he said also in another place, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Verse 7 is that verse of emphasis I want to focus on. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. So that means he was heard. The Bible, this is the writer of Hebrew, we believe is Apostle Paul, summarizing what took place at that Gethsemane where Jesus prayed for 3 hours. The Bible says he sought the face of the Lord with tears. He was weeping. Save me from this cup. I don't want to go to this. Help me. Help me. But guess what? The Bible said he was heard. But me and you, both of us, we know fully well that Jesus died on the cross. He died a shameful and a sorrowful death. So what do the Bible mean that he was heard? I thought if God has heard me, he wouldn't allow him to go to that cross. That's our own definition of answered prayer. We believe that if God don't do it the way you want, he has not answered you, right? But here is the Bible saying otherwise. Jesus was heard. The Father, who is always with him, heard him. Yet, he still passed through that cup. So there must be a confusion here. Guess what the Bible meant by when he says he was heard? He was heard not by taking away the cup from him. When the Bible said that the Father heard him, it means that the Father reassured him of his presence. I am going to that cross with you. Fear not. Somebody will be saying, Apostle, how do you know? I will show you right now. He was heard. But when the Bible said he was heard, it doesn't mean that they took away the cup from him. It meant that the Father reassured him of that abiding presence. I am with you. To somebody, God is already answering your question. Like Apostle Paul, who sought the Lord 3 times, I believe that's in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He said, 3 times I sought the Lord to take away this from me. 3 good times, like our Master Jesus. Of course, he was heard too. But God did not hear
God did not demonstrate that he heard him by taking away that infirmity. God only registered a knowing to him. And what was that knowing in the case of Apostle Paul? God introduced a knowledge to him. And he now said, my grace is sufficient for you. What that means is, I am with you in this. And for you to experience that grace, your weakness must be put in display. So Paul now told us that that grace is made manifest in our weakest moment. So in that your weak moment, it doesn't mean that God had abandoned you. No, he is with you. So in the case of Jesus, I told us that God reassuring him of his abiding presence, that I have a Bible proof of what I'm saying. Isaiah 50 from verse 5 to 10, we read. If you know Isaiah 50 well, it's part of the messianic prophecies of Isaiah. So I had to say that for you to know. The Lord had opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away my back. This is the answer already. So when he prayed, this was the answer he received. What happened at that Gethsemane was that God opened his ear to show him his will. So when he was saying, take away the cup from me, God said, no, my will is that you have to take this cup. This is the feedback we are getting from Gethsemane. The Lord had opened my ear. I was not rebellious, neither turned away my back. So when the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 5 from verse 7 that he was heard, this is the answer. What God did was that God brought a revelation to him that it is my will for you to go through the cross. He now said, okay, if that is your will, I'm not turning my back. If you read the next verses, after that Gethsemane experience, he submitted himself to those who came to arrest him. Why would he submit himself like that without fight? Because he has now discovered that this cup is part of God's will for my life. So that was why he said in Isaiah 50 verse 5, he said that the Lord God had opened my ear and I was not rebellious, neither turned away my back. In other words, when I discovered that his will, I submitted to it. But there was other knowings that God ministered to him. Next verse, he now said, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheek to them that broke off the hair. I hide not my face from shame and spitting, for the Lord will help me. Therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed. Are you seeing it now? So him submitting himself to them that came to arrest him is a product of a knowing, a knowledge that was ministered to him. I am going to the cross with you, my son. Let's go. That is omnipresence. He reassured him of that presence. I am still with you. So he said, you know what? I set my face like a friend. I did not turn my back from those who will beat me. So everything you see them do to him on the cross or what he passed through, he was scourged 39 times, I believe. All of those things that he submitted himself to such humiliation was because of a knowledge. God is with me. When God says he has heard your prayer, sometimes it doesn't mean he will take away the pain. Sometimes it doesn't mean he will take away the cup. Sometimes he allows it to teach you something. Part of the ways we get spiritual knowledge is that God will deal with us. That's, you see, I normally tell people, Bible knowledge is not enough for you to know God. That is the difference between the ministry of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Well, as Jesus was teaching them doctrine, he says, but when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into it. The Holy Ghost comes to give you experience, not just cerebral knowledge. And that was what happened to the disciples. Majorly, what Jesus gave them was like the knowledge part, the doctrinal part. Doctrinal part will not, it's not powerful enough to help you in the days of affliction. That was why Peter, even after everything Jesus taught him, he still denied him 3 times. But after the empowerment of the Holy Ghost came in Acts 2, that same Peter who stood before thousands and defend the gospel, he wasn't even afraid to die again. Now the Holy Ghost has come, so he can now experience all that Jesus has taught him. That becomes what I call experiential knowledge. So Sometimes the reason why God permits us to go through certain things, it doesn't mean he has withdrawn his presence. He's saying you need to pass through this. There is a knowledge you will lack if you don't go through this. How do you want to comfort the afflicted if you've never been afflicted before? You can't heal a pain you've never felt. So the Bible says that we don't have a high priest who is not touched with our infirmities. Yes, sir. So when the Bible says he was heard, it doesn't mean that he took away the cup. He said, you need to go through this. But I'm assuring you of my omnipresence. That ever presence of God. The Lord is talking to somebody who has been questioning. Maybe God has left me. Maybe God is no longer with me. I'm answering it already by the Spirit of God. Let's finish up our scripture. We're still in Isaiah 50. Let's finish it up. He said he is near. This was the knowledge Jesus had that he submitted himself to such humiliation of the cross. He is near that justifieth me. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who is mine adversely? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God will help me. Who is he that shall condemn me? Lo, they all shall wax old as a garment. The moth shall eat them up. I just read verse 9 for you. That was a knowledge he had. Just like Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12, I believe. He said, I know who I have believed. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed into his hand. This was Paul in chains, in prison. He's reaffirming his stand, his faith. Oh, I will not deny him because I know him. You will not have this kind of conviction if you've not been dealt with, if you've not been dealt by God, experience, not just cerebral knowledge. So when you see men submit themselves to certain level of humiliation, there is something they know. When you see men do exploits, there is something they know. Yes, sir. Verse 10 now is applicable to us. I've read Isaiah 50, 5 to 9 for you. Now, let's see verse 10. Now, verse 10, the Lord was now talking to us, his followers. Verse 10, he now say, who among you that feareth the Lord, that obeyeth the voice of his servant, that walketh in darkness and had no light, let him trust in the name of the Lord and stay upon his God. Who among you? He's saying, in case you are experiencing what Jesus had experienced, he said, trust God. He's walking with you all through the process. He had not abandoned you. He's also reassuring you that same assurance he gave to Jesus. Is somebody hearing me? Because part of Satan's... Okay, maybe I will do this before I say this. Isaiah 43 from verse 2. I'm reading from NLT. He says, when you go through the deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. He didn't say you will not go through stuff. In fact, Jesus puts it this way. He says, in the world, you will have so much tribulations. Or so many tribulations. That's the right way to put it. In the world, you will have so many tribulations. He said, but be you of great cheer. I have overcome the world. So run away from any preacher or anybody that is trying to prove to you that because you're a Christian, you will not experience difficulty or trials or affliction again. No, sir. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Yes, sir. But he assured us in Isaiah 43 verse 2 that he's walking with us in it. I am with you. When you pass through that difficulty, I am with you. He's touched with your infirmity. So I don't know what you are experiencing now. The Lord is with you. That's his omnipresence. So like I was saying earlier, part of Satan's trick is to minister doubt in our heart when we are facing such, when we are passing through such situations or when such moments present itself in our life. But you must know this morning from those voice of God you are hearing, God, somebody type God is with me. Type it on the comment section. God is with me. He has not abandoned me. Oh, God is with me. He is always with me. Hallelujah. That was the same thing he came to play on Jesus at the wilderness when he came to tempt him. That's Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. It says, and when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that the stones be made bread. Earlier in Matthew chapter 3, heaven had announced, had made a proclamation, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. And Satan came, beloved Son, and you are here for 30 days with no food. It doesn't make sense. How can he call you beloved and he allow you to pass through this thing? Why will he lock you up in this wilderness? If you are truly his son, then you should prove it though. Because as I'm looking at you now, your life does not show any evidence that you are his beloved son. That's how Satan has been talking to so many people. Sister, you say you are a child of God. At 30, no husband yet. And you are still keeping your virginity. Ha! That's how Satan speaks to us. Brother, you say God has told you you will prosper and excel. But look at your life. Your mates are already driving Range Rover. Your mates are already getting married. You don't even have anything to show that God is with you. Are you really sure you are a child of God? That's how he speaks. He really starts out. But the Bible says he's a liar. In John 8:44, he called him a liar. He's the father of all liars. When he speaks lie. So don't believe him. In fact, I'm bold to tell you that your situation is a lie. That circumstances is a lie. Because the Bible says that everything the eyes can see is temporal. It is subject to change. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 from verse 18. Because Apostle Paul that taught us that we shouldn't focus on what the eyes can see. We focus on what the eyes cannot see. For the things that the eyes can see is temporal. It can change. It is subject to change. So when the devil comes to lie to you, like he came to tempt Jesus, tell him, I know who I believe, like Paul. I know who I believe in. I am persuaded he's able to keep that which I've committed into his hands. I've committed my future into his hands. I've committed my marriage into his hands. I've committed my health. Maybe somebody under the sound of my voice, you have been plagued by an infirmity, and probably you've even stood on several prayer lines and you don't seem to be receiving your healing. It doesn't mean that God is not a healer. That your sickness is actually the real liar here. But God is able to keep that which I commit into his hand. You must have this on your subconscious mind. Can I say this to you? Trials should not be strange to believers. Let me say it again. Passing through trials must not appear strange to you as a believer. 1 Peter chapter 4 from verse 12 and 13. Peter speaking to us, he says, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange things had happened unto you. But rejoice, inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, you may be glad also with exceeding joy. Peter is saying, don't think it's a strange thing for a child of God to go through trials. No, it's part of it. In fact, trials are meant to test your faith. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 7, I read NLT. He said, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies the gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus is revealed to the whole world. Are you following what I'm saying? Because the reason why I'm intentional, I believe God is intentional with this station this season, is because so many people are giving up on God because of temporal trials. No, sir. It is not strange for you to go through storms. He said, but be of great cheer. Be strengthened. Christ has overcome. You are already an overcomer. You are not going to overcome. Jesus has overcome already on your behalf. That automatically makes you an overcomer. This will encourage you when you pass through whatever you are passing through right now. Oh, God is with me. I say it to myself all the time. Don't think I've attained though. There are some days even Satan come to lie to me. But I tell myself, God is with me. God is with me. God is with me. And one of the ways to escape the lying vanities of the enemy is that you look unto Jesus. That's Hebrews chapter 12, 2 to 3. It says, looking unto Jesus. In fact, Amplified presents this way. It's looking away unto Jesus. The reason why they had to act away means you can't be looking at your circumstances and be looking at Jesus at the same time. But the Lord, it will not work. It will not work. You must focus your attention on Him. On Him alone. So Hebrews 12, 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and He sat down, at the right hand of the throne of God. He now says, for consider Him that endured such contradiction of sinners against Himself. He now says, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. As you are passing through your own trials, the Bible says you should consider Him. Think about Him. Focus your attention on Him. That's what it means by saying consider Him. He passed through similar things, but what is the end of the story? He is now glorified. Oh, your trials will bear glory for you. I don't know who I'm talking to. It will bear glory. It will bear glory. It says that our light affliction is only but for a moment. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 from verse 17. It's only but a moment. It's only for a moment. But it is working for us far more exceeding weight of glory. The exchange of my suffering, trials, is that glory is being bred. We also saw that then when I showed you a scripture on 1 Peter. Oh, it will end in praise. It will end in praise. It will end in praise. So run away from the lying vanities the enemy is presenting to you. Run away from it. Run away from it. Run away from it. Something happened in the book of Numbers 21. I think that's from verse 6. When Israel began to murmur in the wilderness, the Lord sent serpents to afflict them. Now, how did they come out of that affliction? They looked at the brazen serpent. Maybe we should read it. Numbers 21, 6 to 9. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they beat the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore, the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, or we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that He take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looked upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, and when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. This is a typology of the cross. That brazen serpent was typifying the cross, the real cross of Jesus. When you are being beaten by circumstances of life, the only way to survive is look at the cross. Focus on that place where it was all paid for. When the enemy comes to accuse you, the accuser of the brethren, focus on the cross. Remove your eyes from the serpents that are biting you. If you focus on what is biting you, you will die, like we saw here. But if you focus on Jesus, you will come out of it. It was all paid for in the cross. Do you remember Peter? How many of you remember Peter? Okay, let's do Matthew chapter 14, 27 to 31. When God commanded Peter to walk on waters, let me show you something there. Matthew 14, 27. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of great cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? I want to talk to somebody. who had been on prayer line since and had never experienced healing. I'm talking to that barren woman who had been prayed for several times and yet no healing. I'm talking to that person who had given up on the power of God. Jesus is never to be blamed. That's what I want you to know this morning. And his presence never left you. This is Peter standing with the Lord himself. In your own case, you are even believing the Lord through faith. I'm talking about the physical Jesus standing before Peter. And he said, Peter, come. And the Bible said, Peter began to walk on waters. That means the moment Jesus spoke, power was released. And Peter was functioning on that power. The moment Peter removed his gaze from Jesus, he began to sink. What happened? Doubt kills the power of God. Let me say it again. Doubt kills the power of God. The moment Satan has managed to convince you that healing is not real, that this, that you don't deserve it, that you don't qualify for it, no matter how powerful that minister that is praying for you is, this already answers the question of someone who has been seeking for miracles and you don't get it. Yet in that same church, people are testifying. The problem is not from the source. You are just the problem. You see, the Christian faith we are in was authored. It was grace that provided it, but we receive it by faith. The Bible says that's Ephesians chapter 2. I believe that's from verse 8. You were saved by grace through faith. Grace provided it. Faith is your withdrawal. So the problem is not the minister. The problem is actually him. If Peter could sink, and guess what? When Christ diagnosed the situation, he said, why did you doubt? The power is still here, but your doubt cut off the operation of the power. But yet, God was with Peter at that moment. So your sickness is not enough proof to say, maybe God has left me. No, sir. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Your barrenness is not a proof that Jesus has left you. No matter what you are passing through, he is with you. So I've shown you from the scripture that God can be with you, yet you can lack result. For Peter, he experienced some little measure of that result. And then he cut it off. He extinguished it through his doubt. Are we following what I'm saying? He is with you. Oh, he is with you. Your situation is a lie. That circumstance is a lie. Daniel knew this. Yes, sir. He knew it. That was why, even when they threw him into the pit, I believe that man never doubted. He was not scared. If Daniel had exercised any form of doubt on the God he has been calling on, those lions will eat him up. He knew that I believe in a God who cannot be locked out, even in the pit. He is with me. What's that powerful song we used to sing? My soul, magnify the Lord, and my spirit, praise his name. For grave could not hold him captive, and even in the grave, Jesus is Lord. Even in the grave, Jesus is Lord. And even in the grave, in your situation, he is still Lord. Barren woman, hear my voice, he is still Lord. That man that lost that contract, hear my voice, he is still Lord. Maybe you just lost your job, he is still Lord. Maybe you lost your husband, he is still Lord. I don't know what you are passing through right now. Our God is still Lord. Jesus is Lord. And even in the grave, Jesus is Lord. Even in the grave, Jesus is Lord. Even in the grave, Jesus is Lord. I believe this was the same revelation that those three Hebrew boys had in Daniel chapter 3. That when they were threatened with the furnace, they said, no, this God we trust on is able to save. Oh, the fire was there, but they said, fire, you are not real. You are not more real than the God we believe on. Can you tell your sickness, you are not real, you are not more real than this God I believe on? Can you tell that temporal situation, you are not more real than the God I believe on? He is able to save me. These are men who we are looking at death, eyeball to eyeball. But it was Job that said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Oh, I know my Redeemer live. I know it. I know it. I know it. Job was a man that lost everything, but he still gathered the confidence to make that confession. I know he's alive. Jesus is alive. Forever he's alive. Amen. He's alive. Amen. He's alive. My Redeemer is alive. Forever he's alive. Amen. Do you believe what I'm teaching you? That's why I'm presenting the scriptures to you, to see that he's alive. Let the scriptures answer your question. Even if you can't trust me, trust the word of God that abideth forever. It was in Isaiah 40 that he says that all flesh withers. He said, but the word of God abideth forever. That's why I'm presenting that which does not lie to you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So when Jonah was caught up in the belly of a fish, just like many of you are caught up on certain situations and circumstances right now, what did he do? At first, the man was complaining. At first, he was lamenting. But the moment he worshipped God right in that belly of the fish could not hold him back again. He commanded the fish to, the Lord commanded the fish to vomit him. It's a long reading, but we can try it out. Jonah chapter 2, 1 to 10. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish belly. Let me run a commentary here. How can a man... Okay, now picture what I'm about to say. It's like an illustration. If you're a swimmer, you understand better. When you are at the bottom of a water, a river, a sea, whatever, would you be able to talk there? The answer is no. Will you be able to breathe there? The answer is no. Because the water must have covered your ears, your eyes, your mouth. But for some people, their belief or their concept of prayer is that you must talk. But now, this verse 1 of this scripture is already contradicting that. Jonah prayed, which means the man did not open his mouth. So how did Jonah communicate to God? He communicated to God through his heart. That's the first thing I want you to see in the scripture. Because he was in the belly of a fish. The belly of a fish is like you being trapped at the belly of an ocean. Right there will be blood and water everywhere. So the man cannot even lift his face. He was covered maybe from whatever the fish must have swallowed up. But he was still able to call on God. You know the reason why I'm pointing out this? So maybe you are caught up in a situation that has almost swallowed you up. You can still communicate to God. Even if you can't talk, your heart is a prayer room. So let me say it again. Your heart is a prayer room. You might not be saying a word, but God hears your heart. He says, unto he that is able to do exceeding abundantly more than we can ever ask or think. In other words, you can ask or think. Whether you are asking or thinking, you are still praying. So Jonah spoke to God through his thoughts. Let's continue now. And he said, I cried by the reason of my affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice, for thou hast cast me into the deep. Now the man was still complaining at this stage. In the midst of the seas and in the floods compassed me about. All my billows and the waves passed over me. Then I said, I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again toward thy holy temple. Let me repeat this verse. Then I said, I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again toward thy holy temple. Somebody, you need to look again. oh, you need to look at Jesus again. Let's continue because of my time. And the water compassed me about, even to the soul. The depth closed me round about. The waves were wrapped about my head. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Yet hast thou brought upon my life from corruption, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee in thy holy temple. Now, verse 8 is my main verse of emphasis. He now came out to the parable. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. Let me stop here for now. Finish up the scripture. If you had followed me through this reading, the man was complaining. I was shut out. I was this. I was that. But I remembered the Lord. You will remain in that situation if you keep murmuring, this my pain, this that, this my... No, remember the Lord. He made a statement, verse 8, Jonah 2:8, they that observe lying vanities, they forsake their own mercy. In other words, even at the belly of a fish, mercy found him. Omnipresence, the abiding presence of God was still there. So even at that belly of the fish, the Lord never left him. But because he was focused on his situation or circumstance, he forsook that mercy. But the moment he looked away from the lying vanities that stands for those things that have threatened your life, the moment he removed his gaze from it and looked to the temple, he looked up to the Lord, mercy embraced him. So he came out, verse 8 is what we can call the parable of Jonah. That they that observe lying vanities, they forsake their own mercy. They reject mercy. Mercy is available. Now, right now, in that your sick bed, mercy is available. But if you keep looking at your temporal situation, you will never experience this mercy. That's the implication of the scripture. They that observe lying vanity, you keep murmuring, you keep complaining. Yes, I accept the fact that you were cheated. I know. I accept the fact that you lost your husband. God will comfort you. He's already comforting you. But it's time to look up to God for a better days ahead of you. Stop rejecting the mercy that is right there with you. That mercy stands for the presence of God. Let's finish up the scripture, verse 9. He now says, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. Salvation here means deliverance is of the Lord. Verse 10. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and he vomited out Jonah out of the dry land. And the Lord spake unto the fish. And the Lord spake unto the fish. And the Lord spake unto the fish. The moment the man turned to God in worship, he turned again his captivity. That is what we are supposed to do. When we remove our gaze from the lying vanity and we focus on Jesus. When you remove your gaze from those things that are strengthening you and focus on him in worship, you are worthy, O God. I know that it will not end in my death. What everything Job passed through, that man held a positive disposition. Oh, I know my Ebenezer live. I know I will see him in the land of the living. Job never gave up. One of the proofs to show that you have faith is through your confession. He said that we have having the same spirit of faith. Say, if you say you have faith, you must say. So Job was saying the right word. He refused to embrace the lying vanity. I know Satan took away his wife. He knew Satan took away all he had. He knew Satan took away his children. But he was still saying, I will see my Lord. I know he's alive. I will see him in the land of the living. I will not go down to the pit. I will see him. He was embracing mercy because he knew of that omnipresent. We are going to pray this morning. It was David that cried out, I said, take away my eyes from the lying vanity. I think that's in Psalms 119. He said, remove my eyes from the lying vanity. For somebody, that's your prayer this morning. Lord, take away my eyes from the lying vanity. Give me the grace to focus on you. Give me the grace to focus on the cross, where my healing has been paid for. For a sick individual under the sound of my voice, the cross has paid for your sickness. But you need to look at that cross. Give me the grace, O God. Oh, remove my eyes from that lying vanity. Remove my gaze from the lying vanity. Help me to believe again. Help down my unbelief, O God. Yes, I believe, but help my unbelief. Is somebody praying? For another person, your own, you need to worship him right now. Like Job, thank you, Lord. It will not end in disgrace. I know I'm coming out of this situation. I know I'm coming out of this pit. I know I'm coming out of this temporary situation. Oh, this sickness is not unto death. It will not kill me. It will rather reveal the greater glory of God. This depth will not swallow me. Oh, I know I'm coming out. I know I'm coming out. Oh, I thank you, Lord. I know I'm coming out strong. I know I'm coming out with testimony. Oh, I know it's for greater glory. Somebody, you need to worship him. For like Jonah, the Lord will speak to that condition to vomit you out. Oh, worship him. Worship him. Sing unto your God. Make melody unto our God. He is faithful. His mercy and love endures. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, we give you praise. We give you praise. Your word has come and it will not return void. I pray for everyone and anyone under the sound of my voice who, like Jonah, you are trapped in a circumstance right now. Maybe it's a sick body. Right now, lay your hand and that part of your body that has been sick. I command that infirmity to leave your body now in the name of Jesus. I bring you the life and the healing power of Jesus. Now from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet, I declare Jesus Christ makes you whole. Right now, get up from that sick bed. Get up from that sick bed. I speak to your legs. I speak to your joints. I speak to your systems. Whatever that has failed, right now, I give new life to your body in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody, that individual that is caught on debt, you don't even know how to pay it. The Lord brings you out of that pit. Now, the Lord brings you out of that pit. Help comes to you. Oh, that sister that is heartbroken, I minister healing right now. I minister healing right for your shame. The Lord gives you double. That one that lost a beloved family member, the Lord ministers healing. The Bible says he's close to those who are heartbroken. He ministers comfort to you now. Whatever it is that looks like the fish that swallowed Jonah, whatever it is that seems like it's about to swallow you or he had already swallowed you, now I speak, come out of that pit. Come out of that pit. Come out of that pit. Let the weight be lifted up. The Bible says that the burden be taken away. The yoke is already broken by the anointing. Right now, by the power and by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, I declare you set free. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, we give you praise. Adonai, we honor you. In Jesus Christ's name we've prayed.